So let's talk about the multiple writer part of it. Note that there could be multiple user data structures present in a given page X. If that is the case, the programmer probably has different locks for accessing different portions of the data structures that happen to all fit within this page X. So it is conceivable that while all of this was going on, there is another processor, let's say P4, and a thread that is running on that processor P4 got a completely different lock, let's say L2, and it is accessing some data structure that happens to be in the same page X. This is perfectly fine. The DSM software is not going to do anything in terms of the diffs that it has created with respect to the page X because of lock acquisition L. That's completely different set of actions compared to a different lock acquisition, say L2. So if in fact that other thread that is running on P4 executed in parallel with P1 got its lock, say L2, and modified X, when P2 gets its lock L, the DSM software is going to bring the diffs only from the previous users of the same lock L. P4 was not using L, it was using L2, even though it accessed the same page, it's modifying a different portion of that page, and therefore DSM software is going to assume that that change made by P4 to X is irrelevant so far as P2's critical section is concerned. So that's the important thing, and that is where the multiple writer coherence protocol semantic comes in, that simultaneously the same page could be modified by several different threads on several different processors, and that is perfectly fine so long as they're using different locks. So the association between the set of changes to a page is only to the specific lock which is being used to govern that critical section. And this is the reason why this is called a multiple writer coherence protocol. And we saw how this multiple writer coherence protocol lives in concert with LRC to reduce the amount of communication that goes on in executing critical sections of an application.